Welcome. Welcome to our fourth Sunday of Advent service, and bring greetings of Strathearn United Church to everyone who is watching our service today. Draw your attention to the various notices that will be in the bulletin that has been sent to you. Just to remind folks that we will be having two options for Christmas Eve. Obviously, you can enjoy both. We will have our YouTube Christmas Eve service, which will be available to watch. And also, at this point, we're planning to have a 10 p.m. communion service on Zoom. That information will be sent out to the congregation members who wish to participate. And as part of that service, we ask that you prepare your own elements for communion. And so we'll be starting around about 10 o'clock on Christmas Eve. There will be also a service on the 27th on YouTube, and we invite you to be part of that as well. And with that, I don't think we have any announcements that I can add to those already there, and we will light our praise candle. Come now, God, creator of all. Come to us in flesh and bone. Bring peace to us who are weary. Bring hope to us who struggle. Seek us out who are lost. Do not forget us, but touch us with your grace. Fill us with your everlasting joy, so that we, fashioned by your hands and shaped in your image, be witnesses to your love. Amen. We shall sing verses 1 and 2 of Ancient Love, Voices United 17. Then we'll enter into our lighting the Advent candle, and then after that, Kathryn will lead us in a piece of music ministry. So verses 1 and 2. I may be wrong, but I think the point is this. What each of us longs for the most is to be both fully known and fully loved. Miraculously, God feels the same way about us. God, too, wants to be fully known and fully loved. The first candle radiates the hope given through Jesus Christ. The second candle calls us to embrace and extend Christ's peace to an unsettled world. The third candle extends the promise of Advent, offers true joy that sustains a weary people. The fourth candle, that is the life of God revealed to us through the birth of a child.
For the mercy of your plan.
let us join together in a new creed. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Let us enter into a time of confession. When we receive forgiveness instead of judgment, we too are made ready to forgive one another. What God does for us, we are owed to others. The more we receive, the more we are able to give, and the more meager our love for one another, the less we are living by God's mercy and love. God, we gather before you in prayer. You invite us to be witnesses to your love, yet we struggle to be so. All too often, we find it difficult to love ourselves and one another as you love us. God, hear our prayer as we offer our brokenness to you. With grace, God invites us to understand what it means to be loved, and doing so challenges us to share this gift with others. Let us begin with prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We shall now sing Mary, Woman of the Promise, Voices United 16.
Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. A reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the virgin, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her, who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
the song of Mary. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour. For God has looked with favour on the lowliness of God's servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is God's name. God's mercy is for those who fear God from generations to generations. God has shown strength with God's arm, has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. God has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. God has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. God has helped God's servant Israel in remembrance of God's mercy, according to the promise God made to our ancestors, to Abraham and his descendants forever. The Christmas season is one where, as a result of tradition and how things are done, we are convinced we know what is going on. And Mary is certainly part of that tradition. Mary, meek and mild, with a beatific smile on her face as she is surrounded by all of the chaos during that first Christmas. Really? Oh, don't mind the mess in these stable, complete strangers who decide to pop in for a visit and just after I've given birth. Would you like me to put the kettle on? To be honest, I think it would be more less of a beatific smile and more of a grimace and an eye roll and a muttering, for Pete's sake, if you're coming in to welcome the incarnation of God in our midst, we'll at least close the door. And what is that smell? Maybe it's a good idea to actually see Mary as someone more grounded in our world than the traditions would imply. And then maybe we are more ready for a Mary who proclaims her faith in God through her song of a vision of what it means to place your hope in God in the midst of the challenges of the world. Because when Mary sings the song, she celebrates the promise of radical possibilities for a world that is weary. And I think, to be blunt, we're living in a time where the world is weary. We need visions of dreams, of radical possibilities, of what it means to place our faith in God. And what a vision, what a song. A clear statement from Mary that God is preparing to act to bring an end to the rules of the powers of this world who have oppressed the people of this world. Not so much a beatific smile, more of a warning grin that things are beginning to get interesting. And with all of the readings of Scripture, we have a habit of divorcing what happened when it was first written to when we hear it now. We listen to Mary with her tradition of nativity scenes, of girls being told to behave themselves when all the chaos of shepherds and camels and whatever they decide to bring in, like maybe it's even the Christmas moose, for example. But you imagine the reality of that song. And in particular, and let's be blunt, if we were to listen to it today, there would be so many who would be profoundly uncomfortable. Luke's gospel was first written as the good news for the Greeks and Romans of the Roman Empire. This was a culture profoundly dominated by a caste of men. I'm not going to use the term white males because color coding in those days was somewhat more complicated, but it was an aristocracy of men. Men of certain families. Men who celebrate the power of armies and money used to control the lives of everyone else, particularly armies. And the only value a woman has in this world is how they can support those dreams of power, and usually that's through bearing children. So for many, Mary, meek and mild, is worthy of honor only because she has been picked to bear the Son of God in whatever fashion that looks like. That's it. She's not supposed to say anything else. The minute she opens her mouth and proclaims a song of the Word of God, stop talking. We're not supposed to hear you, Mary. You know, be quiet. Just be grateful God has chosen you to bear the Son of God. Anything else, like, we don't want to hear it. Tough. When Mary sings her song, there would be people in the audience for Luke's gospel who would have found it offensive that God would choose this teenage girl from a conquered people to be the vessel of God's will. And more important, would be even more offensive that she would sing this song to tell them the days are coming when the Lord will act. You can almost imagine the indignant spluttering of many of these men, some of them even saying to themselves, how can we accept that God, the creator of all, will act through this kiddo? Of course, the minor little detail is that they are missing the point, as privileged men usually do. God has no intention of embracing the expectations of the privileged, especially when God has decided to act. After all, the purpose of the expectations of privilege is that you are using them to contain the power of God in your vain attempt to use God to support the structures of power. So when you say that God supports the oppression of others, yeah, right. You've decided to use God to support the oppression of others because you know you don't actually have much of a leg to stand on, but it's always useful to have God's word on your side. And God's had enough. This is what Mary is saying. God has had enough of being used as a prop to justify the exploitations of others. It is time to bring the powerful from their thrones and lift up the lowly, to fill the hungry with good things and send the rich away empty. Privilege is over, folks. God's back in town. So yeah, there would be men in the audience of Luke's reading, as it were, not liking that one little bit, because what they hear in Mary is not the gentle love of a parent for their child, but also the fierce love of a parent who wants to protect their children from harm. In this came the harm inflicted on people by those who have convinced themselves that they have the right to do so. That is the point of privilege. You convince yourself wrongly you have the right to impose your power on others. And Mary is saying, God has had enough. So there would be some in Luke's audience muttering, is this supposed to be good news? If God acts through Mary and this son to change everything, what happens to my way of life? What happens to my privilege? What happens to my right to oppress others? Come on, God, give me something to work with. That's not good news at all. That's kind of put me off. And what's interesting for me is that, it may be interesting for other people, I don't know, is that Luke starts his work with such a powerful vision. Because later on, Luke actually, it's almost like, oh, wait a second, I need to start appealing to these people. I need to actually start saying nice things about how maybe it's okay to be a Greek and a Roman and keep some of your privileges. Because at the beginning, Luke is clear. Things are changing, folks. Deal with it. An unmarried young woman tainted with shame because of her status, probably with little access to money and power, part of a community with limited influence in the Roman Empire, God is saying is more important than all the priests, kings, governors, and even the emperor himself. Mary is clear. God has had it. God has had enough of people being oppressed, particularly in God's name. That really gets God's goat. God did not create us in God's image so we would find ways to exploit and oppress one another. That was never part of the plan. Now, we've been really good, and it's depressingly impressive how good we are at saying God has. You know, you take a little word here, a little moment here, and boom, all of a sudden, God justifies slavery. God justifies oppression of women. Here it is. Here's your chapter and verse. Oh, no, don't look into the context. No. Don't try and explain how that people thought it was appropriate maybe 2,000 years ago, but now maybe not so appropriate. It's the literal truth of God. Oh, when God says, look after refugees, no, it's not the literal truth of God. God's hope is that we find ways to live together in mutual respect with one another, accepting the diversity of who we are, shaped in the image of the diverse wonder of God. And so God is acting. And God is acting in such a way just to make sure we get the point that all our structures of power and control, in which we invest with so much importance and so much significance, are garbage that can be swept away. Because as far as God is concerned, all these structures of power, control, oppression have blighted God's hopes for us. Why do we have a world where the hungry have to be fed? God created enough for everyone to share in bounty. Why is there rich people in the first place? That is the song of Mary. Not so much meek and mild, somewhat peeved. And Mary is celebrating how God chooses to act. That God has chosen a person like her to be a living witness to the hope of God amongst us. That God does not judge who is important and who is not in the way that we do. What God searches for is a willingness for us to be transformed through our encounter with God so we can embrace the possibility that we will fulfill God's hope in us, and in doing so, share this hope with others. It is to be part of the story of God's love for all of humanity. And as Mary celebrates, it is a story that will continue to flourish despite the realities of the struggle we face, because God is with us. The path of the story will follow new directions. It will go out through the Roman Empire and beyond all corners of the earth. It will invite a wide variety of people to be part of it, as together they explore new radical possibilities of lives being changed by the good news. And through it all will be the wonder of being touched by God's love and discovering that this is a love to be shared through our willingness to love one another as we have been loved by God. Amen. As always, we come to our time of offering, which has evolved, as it were, into our time of giving thanks for the many people who have contributed to the ongoing life of our congregation in these difficult times, of the people who have worked behind the scenes to ensure that these services continue, of the people who have continued to offer generously to the life of the church, And I'm generally giving thanks for all the infrastructure that allows us to continue to be the body of Christ in this area. Let us gather before God in prayer. God, in this time of Advent, you wait with us, waiting for the right time in which to discover who we are, where we must go, who will be with us, and what we must do. God, we thank you for this waiting time. God, you keep us looking. You invite and challenge us to look in all the right and wrong places for signs of hope for people who are hopeless, for visions of a better world which will appear among the disappointments of the world we know. God, thank you for the looking time. God, you keep us loving. You invite and challenge us to be like you, to love the loveless and unlovely and the unlovable, to love without jealousy or design or threat, and most difficult of all, to love ourselves. God, thank you for this loving time. God, in all of us, you keep us. Through hard questions with no easy answers, for failing where we hoped to succeed and making an impact when we felt we were useless, through patience and the dreams and love of others, and through Jesus Christ and the Spirit, God, you keep us. God, thank you for the keeping time. And God, we come to you with the prayers of our hearts. We continue in our thanksgiving for all who continue to serve in these difficult days, for all in healthcare, for all in essential industries, for all who bring comfort, for all who are connected. In silence, O God, we bring these names to you of the people in our lives who we give thanks. Lord, we pray for our world, struggling with the blight of COVID-19. We realize that there is hope, a vaccine. We give thanks for the scientists, the distribution structures, the healthcare workers, those who will ensure that the vaccine is given to those in need, given to those as part of our society, so in time we can continue the journey of healing and recovery. We pray for all who struggle with uncertainty in this time, political, economic, social. We pray for those who struggle with theories, conspiracies, angst. We pray that wisdom and compassion open the hearts of those who turn away from the proper ways of dealing with this COVID-19 virus, to renew our commitment as a society to face this struggle together. And God, we come before you with the prayers of our hearts for those who we know who struggle with illness of the mind, body, and spirit, for those who are alone, for those who yearn for connection. In silence, we bring these names to you. Amen. We shall close with In the Bleak Midwinter, Voices United 55. What commandment is the first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength.' The second is this, 'You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.'"